Hello, everybody. Welcome back to Five Questions. I'm Sarah Downey, the president and CEO of the Michael Garron Hospital. And it's my pleasure to have back Dr. Jeff Powis, who's the medical director of infection prevention and control and ID doctor at Michael Garron, and who is a frequent guest and answer of questions in this setting. So welcome back, Dr. Powis.
Thank you, Sarah.
So I wanted to talk about a couple things today. One is COVID and wave two. The other is influenza and the confluence, perhaps, of these two illnesses. But let's start with the COVID question, and that is, are we in wave two of COVID?
So for sure, we're in wave two. There are different definitions about what is a quote-unquote wave of COVID. But when we start seeing case counts increasing in the community and subsequently increasing resource utilization in the hospital, we are firmly in the midst of the second wave of COVID.
And what are we doing to prepare? Or what have we done to prepare for wave two?
Yeah, I would say there's two major strategies that we as a Ontario Health team are utilizing to try and tackle wave two. The first is really trying to focus on our strategy of testing in the community, getting testing to our communities that have high amounts of health inequity. Because we know low barrier testing is key to implement things like case management that we're doing here at our own hospital to try and mitigate the chance that somebody passes on to someone else. We know the best tool to prevent school outbreaks, hospital outbreaks, long-term care outbreaks is to reduce the amount of COVID in our community. I think the second strategy is just looking at our own internal resource and how we're trying to make sure of enough flexibility to meet the needs of what may be coming as far as increasing use of our hospital resources with people who need hospital level care.
And how long do you think this wave will last? Where do you think we are in the wave and how long do you think it'll last?
Yeah, so I think we are unfortunately still on the way up. With COVID, based on other experiences in other countries and other provinces, even within Canada, it seems as though the numbers will continue to increase until something is done from a broad public health perspective to start driving those numbers down. And that's when we start seeing the other side of a wave. And so we really need to start seeing case counts decreasing. Now, when you look at case counts, we have to look at, well, who we're testing. You do see case counts starting to drop a bit in Ontario now, but that's predominantly due to the fact that we've changed our testing strategy. Our testing people are only symptomatic. So really, I think what we're going to need to see is some broader-based public health initiatives to start really driving down the number of cases. And people always talk about something called an R-naught. That's how many people is somebody going to pass COVID onto. We need to get that number less than one. And currently, the strategies we have to do that are public health interventions that are community-based.
So we, our province implemented some stricter guidelines a few weeks ago, I think the end of September, or at least before Thanksgiving. Do you think they're taking effect, or do you think further are required?
It's such a challenging thing. And again, it's a challenging thing for our government to try and understand what is the right balance. Understand there's competing economic priorities versus public health priorities. And again, these are really challenging conversations. I really believe though, we will need to take some additional public health interventions in order to drive down case counts and reduce that R-naught to less than one.
Okay, thanks. So I want to shift a bit to the flu. What are we anticipating in terms of a flu season this year? And is it still important to get a flu shot if we're all wearing masks?
Yeah, so that's a great question. We do have some experience from the Southern Hemisphere about what they saw from flu. They did see less flu, which may be related to these things that we've done in the community, such as mask wearing, hand hygiene, social distancing. But the thing that I would say is that if I had a COVID vaccine, there'd be a very long lineup outside of MGH right now. We actually have a flu vaccine that is efficacious to reduce the amount of flu in our community. And as an ID doctor, I feel like it might be the straw that breaks the camel's back. If we have COVID and we're really focusing all our effort on that to also have to deal with flu outbreaks in the hospital, it is really going to really be challenging on us internally to manage that, but also long-term care and other congregate living settings. And so I would say we should really maximize the tools we have available so we don't have to think or deal with flu this year because we need to focus on our COVID efforts.
And what are you observing about either in our hospital about staff getting flu vaccine this year?
Yeah, so I would certainly see the message seems to be getting out. People are coming to get the flu vaccine. We last year got up to about 42% of our staff having the flu vaccine, and into our program about 3 weeks, we already have 40% of people, and people continuing to come each day to get the flu vaccine. So I do think that message has gotten out. And for our staff, it's so critical because we know that the number of people in a ward that get vaccinated, the lower chance it is that ward will have a flu outbreak.
Great. And I think we're seeing, or at least hearing, that in the community, people are getting greater flu vaccines through pharmacies or their family doctors. Can you tell me, are we likely to run out of flu vaccine this season?
So I think we've seen pretty unprecedented demands in the first few weeks of the campaign. I have heard, although I'm not the one who orders it, that we have a plenty of flu vaccine. What we're finding is they're allocating smaller amounts to all of us. And so we are kind of having to frequently go back to the ministry supply to ask for it. But I have been told there is enough, and I'm not going to change our vaccination strategy or the advice I give my patients and family and friends, not to go get it because we're worried about the supply running out. I think we should still all seek to get the flu shot.
Great. So how can you tell? I think the symptoms of influenza and COVID are somewhat similar. How can you tell if you have symptoms, if sniffles or fever or malaise? How do I know what I have?
Yeah. And again, I think this is a really important message to get out, is that what I've noticed is that calling people who have COVID, they all say, oh, I thought I just had a cold. I thought I just had the flu. But the symptoms of a traditional cold, so a non-flu, non-COVID virus, COVID and influenza, you can imagine a three-ball Venn diagram, and there's a ton of overlap. And really the only way to differentiate them is to get a test. We will be testing for flu and COVID starting in November. So if you do come to get a test, we'll be able to differentiate those by using the PCR methods that we've been using throughout this. The thing I would let people know about is that COVID presents in such a variety of different ways, and particularly age is important about how people present, with younger people presenting with less severe symptoms than older individuals. And so people who are younger can be fooled into thinking this is just another cold, but it may actually be COVID. And I think that as a younger person, not that I'm included in that group, but as a younger person, if you do have symptoms, you know, as a public duty, you should go get tested to know, because you don't want to expose any of your loved ones or family who might be older and more vulnerable.
Right. So maybe we can talk a second about testing then as our final question. We're still doing a lot of COVID-19 testing at Michael Garron. What are your thoughts going into the rest of the season about testing for flu and testing for COVID, and what's our approach going to be?
Right. So I think one of the things that we've done within our Ontario Health team, and I mentioned it at the beginning as one of our important strategies, is that we really want to try and expand access to testing in our community. So make sure that people have the ability to do low barrier testing. We know if there's a long lineup or there's a challenging booking system, that people will tend to, oh, it's just a cold, wait a day or two, feel better and not go to get testing. And so we need to make sure we make testing available. So it has to be proximal to people, has to be close, and also needs to be low barrier as far as their ability to access that testing. And so that's one of our big strategies. We're going to be pushing out more of our pop-up centers for COVID testing into our community. And so I'm hoping with that we'll be able to make it so that anyone in our community wants to get testing can do that with low barrier.
That's great. Well, thanks very much for updating us on COVID-19 and influenza, and for giving us a sense of what's going on at Michael Garron Hospital and across our community to try to keep everybody safe during this really challenging pandemic. Thanks again, Dr. Powis, and I'm sure we'll talk again soon.
I'm sure we will. Yes, thanks, Sarah.